all due respect. With 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 all due respect.
How y'all doing today? We are the With All Due Respect podcast. I'm your host, Mo. This is the co-host, Lady Simone. And our special guest today, activist, business owner, pastor, avid spades player, Pastor Curtis Johnson. How you doing today, sir?
I'm good, man. Good.
Appreciate you actually coming on the show today.
Thank you. Glad to be here. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir. You got a busy job, sir.
Yeah.
Oh, sir. You know what? Busy something life. Else I forgot to add. Radio personality as
yeah,
well.
That's yeah, that's those
in here. Yeah,
I get confused sometimes myself.
Which hat do you actually enjoy wearing the most?
You know what's weird is that I don't know that I could choose one over the other.
No.
I would say, you know, obviously first I'm a pastor. I feel obligated to the people that God has assigned me to. As a radio host, you know, I get the opportunity to speak to a lot of people in a vast area that, you know, may never go to church.
I never looked at it like that.
Yeah.
Every day.
But I mean, I get letters, man, from prison. You know,
wow.
Folks who, they don't get to go to church, but, you know, they heard something that was said, or, you know, and they'll send us to the door. They'll handwrite a letter. It means a lot to get a 3 or 4 page letter from prison. Somebody that has has nothing, but they took the time out to communicate to me how much the show meant to them. You know what I'm saying? So, stuff like that. And then, as an activist, that's a lot of stuff that we need to fight for. The rest.
And you know, I've actually called you before and asked, you know, just to make sure you're all right, Pastor Johnson, you're good. I said, I don't need anything. I don't need a prayer, which I'll take one at any time. But I've called you before just to check on you.
Yeah, you have.
Whatnot. Like, appreciate are you doing okay and whatnot? Because in a situation like that, when you have people when you have someone that's actually becoming a voice for, some would say the voiceless, you put a target on your back. And in some cases, some would even say, you'll get to a point where it's like, all right, we can't allow him to get any bigger. Almost like the scene in Malcolm X when it was like, one black man should not have all that power. Yeah. Are you ever concerned in situations like that?
To be honest with you, no, I'm not. I got to add one more thing that I do now. It just made me think of it. I just recently became certified through the King's Center.
Yes,
I'm an authorized nonviolence 365 trainer, which is the principles and steps of Dr. King's nonviolence strategies, social training. And I'm going through a 5-month process to get me trained in that. I bring that up because I think that Dr. King had a major answer to even what's going on now, to deal with issues of nonviolence and to get a mindset of a lifestyle of nonviolence. Is not just about physical violence, but about, you know, becoming sensitive to not injuring people with emotional violence or attacking your personhood, that kind of thing. You know? So changing that mindset is critical. So to answer your question, and I'll be honest, I don't know that I've ever shared this publicly, but I think eventually it's going to be somewhere in that line that I'll probably be the way I leave it for something. I don't know how. I don't think it'll be a time soon. I don't think I've shaken up anything yet. I'm addressing state prison systems. And, you know, we're going down to state house.
Yeah, because we actually see you post that you went down to
the
state.
Yeah. Well, we're touring the state prisons, you know, after the massacre at Lee County Correctional Institution last year, where so many inmates were killed and so many inmates were injured, and there was just like no expression of care from that prison. It just augmented a lot of information that we had been receiving of people who were in prison. We were talking about the conditions of the prison and stuff like that. So my point for bringing that out is it seems like each of the different things I have my hands on has some relevance to the issues of justice, to the issues of racism, to the issues of transforming a mindset within our community and our culture. Right now, I haven't made enough noise to become a threat, but I do believe that I'm on the side. And I think that if some of the things that if we push, those of us who are passionate about these issues, if we keep pushing, some systems will eventually change.
Absolutely.
So there, with you saying that, like, there's something that me and Marin talks about a lot of the times, and he's saying that he feels like he has to stand up for something, and he feels if it was his time to go and he goes out that way, he was okay with that.
I've learned to become okay with
yeah,
that.
Yeah, he learned, yes. Yes, learn to become okay with that. Is it something that you feel that you're so passionate about that it's okay? Like, I feel like that is my God-given duty. I have to do this. And if that's how it is, that's just how it is. And did you have to build yourself up to be okay with that? Or is it something that's, like, because it's kind of scary.
I'm going to give you a real life example. The year of the Charleston shooting was 2015. I just recently shared this in court a few months ago that I never talked about prejudice. I was preaching. I started up preaching. It was just a couple months after Charleston. And while I'm preaching, you know, from my position, my standpoint, I can look out of the glass and see people coming down the driveway to the parking lot. So as I'm preaching, I saw this white man. I mean, it's summertime. He's got this big coat on. And he comes walking off the street all the way down to the sanctuary, to the church, enters into the church, and he sat down in the back seat, in the back row. And he was, I'm preaching. And the usher saw it, all the congregation is looking at me. I'm looking around, and one of the brothers, you know, just kind of looked at him. He went ahead to the back, Brother Bond, he went back to the back and sat near him. But in that moment, it was, while I'm preaching, I process, what am I going to do if this guy does something? And I literally decided, I went all the way through, okay, if he kills me, if he walks up and comes down this aisle, coming out of this pulpit, it's going to be me and him. And if I got to go, I got to go. I'm okay with it. That's how quick the process happened. It went through my mind. I mean, people are looking at me and I'm trying to preach and I know I'm distracted. And people are like, they don't know why I'm distracted. But that was the moment I accepted that if I have to die for this, I will. And from that moment forward, I haven't had a fear.
How's your family take to the strategy? Because with me even saying that, and I'm not, it wasn't to the extent of your situation. It was more like, you know, you have this narrative going around where black women feel like they're not protected, right?
Yeah.
Or just people in general. And I said, if I'm walking into Walmart late one night out of work and I see a young lady that's walking out, she's being handled, I feel like it's my duty
to
intervene. Even if in that situation, my life might be up in order to save someone else's. I have to be okay with that.
Yeah, we do.
And I told my wife that, and I told my kids that, and even up to a situation where just recently with a rapper, Nipsey Hussle died, and we was talking about that because I'm a big fan of him, very big fan, as far as his music, his business, everything whatsoever. And I told my wife, I was speaking to her one night, I said, are we being selfish to still want him here when his job was done? And even in that sense of it, Laura London, which is his girlfriend and the kids and whatnot, this was his job right here while he was here. And how do we actually measure that right there? There was, you have Mars, you have the Hueys, you have the MLKs, so forth and so on. And I put him in the same tone, same conversation with those individuals. And she said that's still not fair. I believe that's what you said, correct?
I feel like I understand, and I guess it's one of those things as a wife, it's so hard when you think about your kids. You understand the purpose that you know, your significant other has, and you understand the passion that they have behind it, and, you know, you understand that if it's a God-given duty and they feel like that, you know, you can possibly understand that too. But then it's like that sense of
selfishness. In a sense.
Yes, it's almost like I feel like, I guess I'm not there. You know, it's the, it takes a certain level to be when you say you have to get at peace.
I would say that a couple of ways I would respond to that. One, honestly, being in the 5-month process I was in training for this nonviolent 365, and having a study of the life of Dr. King, Loretta King, and hearing from Bernice, and hearing from the people that work with them, digging deeper and deeper into each of the different campaigns, or a lot of the campaigns that they conducted, and learning the mindset that was involved in that. A lot of people don't know that Coretta King started the King Center 3 months after Dr. King was killed. Still in mourning. Even after he was killed, he had been planning to do a march. She went ahead and did the march a few days after. Why is this relevant? Ms. King said something that I never forgot. She said, because we were in a private meeting one time before, Ms. Bishop A.D. Long and Greta King and several of us, there's a few dozen of us pastors just having a conversation with her. Bishop Long asked her, how is it that you were so able to manage 4 children and be so supportive of him and, you know, let him go all over the world, etc.? She said, because I was as married to the mission as he was. And I never forgot that. She knew that God had assigned him to the world. And he wasn't just her husband. He wasn't just the children's father. That's the natural way every woman is going to feel. You know, I mean, my wife and I, we deal with. It's still a struggle that I don't get to be, you know, we don't get to hang out on Saturday night, you know, because I'm getting ready for Sunday. Or Sundays, I don't just get to go to the beach with some other folks. But, you know, I mean, yeah, sacrifices with anything. You know, but, you know, I don't know how to make it easier on families if we have to make ourselves available to even do sacrifices. But when you have a sense of mission, when you have a sense of purpose, you realize that you're serving something bigger than you. And at the end of the day, this is what Jesus is all about. Nobody takes my life, I lay it down. Because he knew that his purpose was bigger than his preservation. So, does that make sense?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes. So, I mean, I don't know how that makes anybody feel more comfortable, but you know, this life is temporary.
How did you actually get so close to the King family?
That same conversation I was talking about with Bishop Long, I was under the covering of Bishop Long for several years. And Elder Bernice King became ordained under Bishop Long. And, you know, she was there for part of that church. So when Bishop Long had these little private meetings with a lot of the pastors that he mentors, there was one particular meeting. Coretta King was there, Bernice was there, and these candid conversations. So they made themselves available for book signing. And I went over and just introduced myself. And quite honestly, Coretta called Bernice over there. You know, I don't know if she's going to the same way. Miss Coretta King called Bernice over there. And we sat there and just talked. And they gave me books. And I have in my office now, you know, a book that she gave me about the King that she, Coretta King, autographed. And we just sat there and talked, and I invited Bernice to come up and preach. And we just connected, you know. And the other times that we would just become like literally brother and sister. God really used me at some seasons when she was going through some very difficult times. He helped pour into her. And I don't know, it was weird. It was like, how is it that God is connected to this legacy, and now she's my boss. You know, I just went to Michigan. I had to go to South Carolina, Michigan 2 weeks ago on an assignment from the Kings.
Really?
So we'll be doing that. We're going to different places around the country and sometimes around the world. We get calls to go and address groups of people or youth or governments or organizations or companies or whatever. And so, yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
And we have a conversation all the time, and one of the things that we talk about is that it's so many things going on within our community, just with our, you know, with our people. Like, what is some things, how do you feel we can change that? Because one thing that I always tell him is the change that we want to be is what we have to, well, we have to be the change that we would like to see. So I work a lot closely with kids. So it bothers me to see this generation coming up, and then we have, like, disrespectful kids, or we have kids that, like, when I was growing up, it's certain things we couldn't do. And these kids have no boundaries. So I get stuck and frustrated as into how can I kind of change that narrative for them, but then I can pour into them, but then they go back to their situation. So I'm left kind of, like, empty-handed, like, what is it to do?
It's about parents.
Okay, but even with the parents, you speak to the parents, it's a situation, and by no means are we, no means, shape, or form, are we perfect.
No,
because I've called you again on the case, like Pastor Johnson. I've called you like 3-4 in the morning before. I'm like, I know he's going to get upset, but I got to talk right now. But nonetheless, it's almost like you kind of want to give up hope in a sense, like this. One of the things I've always said is when you open yourself up for love, you also open yourself up just as equally as much as for hurt. And at some point, when do you get to that point, like, you know what? Like, I take my hand, man. I'm done. Y'all just go ahead and whatever.
How can you get to that point?
Yeah. Well, this is a situation that we're currently in right now, as far as just like, man, is there any hope for people in general?
What's going on, y'all? This is your main man, Mo. One third of the With All Due Respect podcast. And I'm seeing more and more guys who aren't taking their grooming responsibilities seriously out here. With these unfortunate fades, these radical razor bumps, and my personal favorite, subjective shape-ups. I can understand trying to save a dollar, but there are some things you just can't afford to cut corners on. But I have a solution, fellas. A1 Advanced Grooming. A1 Advanced Grooming is your one-stop shop for hair and skin appropriation. A1 Advanced Grooming is owned and operated by Tristan Jackson, who offers an array of different things, such as a beard luster wash, thermal scrub, and Alaskan mask facial, just to name a few. So go ahead and book your next appointment with Mr. A1 Cuts and Style Seats. Also check him out on Facebook under Tristan Jackson, as well as on IG as Mr. A1 Cuts. You'll thank me later. It's your main man, Mo.
Like, she almost got hit yesterday walking across the street from Audi's, and clearly it was a stop sign right there. But you're in a rush in a confined parking space. How far are you really going to go and how fast? Like, it's almost like people don't care enough for each other anymore. So where is the balance at? I guess is a better way of saying it. Where is the balance at? Like you care, but then you don't care. You worry about yourself, and you. Where's the balance at?
I don't know that there will ever be a balance. I will say that you have to pick your battles. You know, I mean, there's a lot of stuff out here that needs to change. Mindsets that have been ingrained through many generations, what the scriptures call strongholds. It's a way of thinking that is so ingrained. We're not going to win everybody. We're not going to change everybody's mind. And when I've done all I can, that's all I can do.
How do you measure that? If you actually went further enough, or how do you actually measure that? I know, I understand it's a self thing, so how do you actually measure that?
Well, I have to be honest, I think that God gives every individual choice, and I don't know that, I will say this, after 26 years of pastoring, there were times early in my ministry that I would go over and above and beyond and pour out everything I had, chasing people that was on drugs at 3 or 4 in the morning, bringing homeless people who live in my house. Open ourselves up to all kind of craziness. That's a lot of zeal. There's a lot of sincere desire. Probably not a lot of wisdom. across the grown me now, I've learned that there are some people I'm not going to be able to change. If I see interest, if I see desire, if I see willingness to try, I'll work with you. But if you're going to be stubborn and hard-headed and just resist everything that I try to offer you, I don't have the patience to keep trying to kill myself, trying to help improve your life, and you don't want to change. I'm not God. There are some things I just have to say, Lord, it's yours. As for me, I got to find another battle that I might be able to.
Somewhere within those stages, did it ever take a toll on you personally? I'm pretty sure it took a toll on your family, but just you as a man, like, you know what? Yeah. You're torn.
It did. I've gone through many seasons of burnout. It's like you're grinding like in first gear and not being able to shift. So you're just trying to go first gear on the highway, on the interstate. You're just pushing the gas. I look at that as brown. And so just as with that stick shift, you have to shift sometimes. You got to push the clutch, release the gas, so that allows me opportunity to back up for a minute. Readjust my mindset so I can go into the next gear, but I'm not going to stay in this first gear and keep grinding these gears if I'm not moving. So, you know what I'm saying? So, pull back. Like last week, Council Bible Studies, 12 and 7. I hadn't taken a break. I don't think I took a day off since December last year. So, forget it. I'm just taking a break. I did my insurance business the other day, but I just needed that. It's like,
see, that's the difference. That's the head of the household taking care of business. That's taking care of my household.
Yeah.
Let alone taking care of this right here, the church. So
yeah. Yeah. You know, I'm blessed with a great church in terms of. People, they look out for me. They don't give me a hard time. You know, they know I've tried to do everything I could. To the ministry, they appreciate that. So that means a lot. It's just me. My wife and my family get frustrated because sometimes I don't know how to rest. You know, I don't know how to back away. But it just depends on what I got. Like right now, I got a major issue I'm dealing with. For the first 6 months of this year, I got to grind. I explained that to my family. You know, they're older now. My sons are older. Isaiah's moved to Tennessee. Joshua, you know, he's got a job. He's doing his thing. So they don't have the demand. They understand it now. You know, but when I was younger, when they were younger, it was difficult. It was difficult for my family.
I find it difficult myself with us even starting with it that we're doing. This right here ultimately is just I like to tell people, this is a diving board into a ocean or a pool, rather, opportunity right here.
Right.
So we actually hold conversations with our kids. I even pull my oldest son to the side. This is a little bit more, he'll comprehend it a little bit more. Granted, he's 11, but he understands it.
Mm-hmm.
And it still takes a toll on me.
Mm-hmm.
Like today, we went to go see the new Avengers movie yesterday. Granted, to say it was sold out.
Mm-hmm.
So this morning, like I called you and I told you I had a table read because I'm a part of this film called Tools. He's like, Dad, can we go check out the movie today? I'm like, son, I got to leave here at 1:00. You know, we got to meet with somebody that's interested in being a part of the film at 2:00. Then the actual table read starts from 3:00 and ends at 5:00. And then right after that, we had to sit down with Pastor Johnson for the podcast. I said, we probably won't get home till 8:30. The movie's 3 hours. So I said, we're not going to be able to do that today. With me working second shift, which is 3 to 11, it doesn't give us no time throughout the week. So it's one of those things, and it hurts me at times. Once situation that took place, and I tell people the story all the time, my son plays basketball. He said, Dad, can you come to my game? I said, well, son, you know, I work second shift. He said, well, ask your supervisor, can you have ball? That right there bothered me off top, for me to ask another man, can I have ball to go to my son's game? But I understand the change. So when I came back to him, I said, well, son, supervisor said, I can't have off. He said, well, Dad, I don't understand, because if it was his son, he would go to his son's game. So why can't he come to your son's game? So it's one of those things that's just like, And to say that he's at a young age and he understands, that still doesn't mean it's okay within his mind.
Of course.
Your sons are to the point where they're pretty much young men and men. And they're about to embark on this as well. Even if they pick up where dad left off at, or just in general, they're about to understand exactly what dad has been doing.
Right.
But me with the 11-year-old, with an 11-year-old, 8-year-old, 2-year-old,
it's difficult.
You know, one third of my day is at work.
Absolutely.
So it's yeah.
And you have to do what you got to do to make sure that, you know, the bills are paid. I understand that.
And even at times, we may bump heads on it. Like, well, I got, like, look here, I, you know, in the beginning stages of this right here, I'm like, she's like, I need some me time. I'm like, so ultimately, you're making me choose here. And with me, just as well as yourself, humbly, I feel like I have a mission I got to take care of. And I can't allow anything or anyone to get in that, get in the way of that. And I'm still learning while I'm on this mission.
Right.
It's very early stages. But it's you get pulled in so many different directions.
Right.
And it's still a task. And it's still a heavy burden to wear.
It is. I think that I go back to the thing about picking your choosing the battles. I don't think that you're the person that just wants to just stay at that 311. You know,
no,
you want to get to the place where you can have the freedom to set your own self. You're an entrepreneur by nature. You know, this is an initiative that you guys are launching. So I just say sometimes you have to do what you have to do until you get to do what you want to do. So this is just that season. I mean, they don't understand it now. They'll understand it.
Season is rough, Pastor. So
yeah,
I'll tell you, I'm not gonna lie to you. It's rough.
No doubt.
It's really rough.
No doubt. That's why you do have to, I would say this, use your time wisely so that those moments that you can share with the kids and you can share with the family, you protect your time as much as you can. I'm all for this. I respect what you're doing. But make sure you do prioritize the time that you can have so that they don't know that, you know, this children spell love, T-I-M-E.
Sir. Even some kids are sniffing it out there too.
No doubt. Especially, you know, at first, love language is quality time, you know.
Yeah.
That's the way they speak. Love is the time. So I would say, you know, there are some things that, you know, I mean, it sounds crazy, but as much as I do, I know I can't do it. You know, I'd set my goals at least 2 or 3 times out of the week. I want to be at home with my family every day. And now that I have, this 6 months is a little difficult because I got to get the things done. But I'm just at that place now, just with them being older, they understand. You know, he's working. But when I can be there, when I can be at home, when I can let everybody else know this is family time, and protect that and make that a priority. Family, family, for sure.
With you having so many different things going on, do you see a time of just letting it all, like, can you just see yourself just laying it all down and it's just that rest period?
You mean for a season of rest?
Yes.
Yeah, I feel it. Yeah, we're looking forward to going to California for Charlotte's family reunion. Business, money I generate from my business in the next couple days to pay for our entire trip. I'm going to make up, she said to me last year that she wanted to do this year, so I'm going to make that happen. And that's going to probably be about 10 days or so.
Yeah, that's a vacation right there.
Yeah.
I love getting away when I can. And it's just a matter of just focusing on it, scheduling it, and sticking to it.
Even when I'm sitting here with you, understanding that you are a busy man, so we're about to wrap this up because you know your time is important. With you wearing all these different hats, and people always calling you, always calling you like, Pastor, we need a prayer, or Pastor, can you come to the hospital, which you have done for me before. What's one of the things that you actually enjoy doing in your downtime outside of all the different hats that you
You know, I just came to hear from.
What's that?
Bowling alley, man. We have church bowling league. Sunday afternoon, when football season not in, got nothing to do on Sunday afternoon. So we have a 10-week bowling league. That you know, I'm pretty good.
That's my next question.
You know what I'm saying? I do my thing. You know, I mean, I'm competitive. The people that
run
with me, you know what I'm saying?
Because Super Bowl night, you talk trash playing spades.
You know, spades, bro.
You have your own deck with a gold.
I got two gold decks of cards, man. I got a black deck of cards. People are like bringing cards from around the world to me. You know what I'm saying? These international cards and stuff. But you know, I mean, spades, bowling, pool. You know,
you're good at pool.
Hey, I do my thing, you know.
Okay.
I'm not a superstar, but I do my thing. You know. But you know, I'm meant to win it. What if I do? You know. So, I love you. In that regard, yeah. You know, I'm not competitive when it comes to ministry, but every other way, I'm meant to win.
You know? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hey, Smong, you have anything for Pastor Johnson?
No, that is all. Thank you so much for sitting down with us, and definitely gave us a lot of stuff.
Absolutely.
A lot of
stuff. Absolutely. Yes. It was a lot of answers to questions that we were actually having amongst ourselves. And I'll be honest with you, even for myself personally.
Yeah.
Even it may seem like I took over the interview, but nonetheless, this right here was really like I really need to hear this for myself.
No doubt. Yeah,
thank you as well. Is there anything you'd like to leave?
I would just say, man, I really appreciate the opportunity to spend time with you all and share with your audience. And, you know, I mean, I still get a kick out of people actually wanting to talk to me and learn, you know, stuff that I'm doing. You know, I mean,
you are a big deal, sir. Thing, man. You're a big deal. You're a celebrity here in the Upstate. I don't want to limit you to the Upstate, but you're a celebrity.
Yeah, well, I play radio game. So I appreciate it. I appreciate it, man. I mean, I don't know. I've always felt like I have an assignment to this community in some way. Wanted to do different things that can somehow positively impact race relations or, you know, matters of justice, matters of poverty, or whatever those things are. And it's like whatever passions God put in your heart, it's like the universe attracts it to you. You know
yes,
what I'm
sir.
Saying?
Yes,
and I have to be honest, I don't get as many calls. I think people know I'm crazy and busy, you know what I mean? So they don't, people really don't, you know. I do get calls every once in a while, you know, that this is, I need to know, you know, that there's a prison situation or there's a, you know, something that people need to go see or whatever the case is. I get calls, but at the church, I think people understand, you know, they'll try to call others, you know. They just need Pastor Dale, you know, we'll go there. I love to be there for my people when I can, you know. But, I'll be honest with you, the people around this community have been very good. You know, they've been very understanding and generally speaking, you know, you got a few, you know, haters or whatever the case is. Generally speaking, man, I've been blessed.
Pastor Johnson, we appreciate your time.
Thank you, bro. Appreciate it, man.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
You need a plug?
Thank you.
Anything you'd like to plug?
Listen. If you don't have life insurance, hit me up. If you need burial insurance, real talk. We're building a team, and I'd be glad to help. And check me out on Sunday morning, 7 to 1 on 107.3 Jams. And come see us at Valley Brook, 8323 Augusta Road. Thanks.
Appreciate you again, Pastor Johnson. This is the With All Due Respect podcast with your man, Mo, Lady Simone. Our special guest, Pastor Johnson. Appreciate y'all. Appreciate you again, Pastor Johnson. Until next time, peace.
What's going on, y'all? This is your main man, Mo, one third of the With All Due Respect podcast. And I got a confession. I got a confession, y'all. For those who don't know, I got a major sweet tooth. There it is. There it is. I laid it at the altar. I got a major sweet tooth, y'all. And I'm not talking about no peanut M&Ms and no Jolly Ranchers and no lemon heads. I like cakes. I'll tell you how bad it got. Heaven Father help me with this story. I went a whole month ordering cakes from Publix. A whole month, every week I ordered an 8-inch round cake with a different name on it, as if I was going to a different birthday party every week and I was in charge of the cakes. Till my homeboy pulled me off to the side and said, Mo, you got a problem. But nonetheless, if you're going to do this cake thing, I need you to get a real cake. Those are frozen cakes. I was shocked. I was floored. I was hurt. I was appalled. But what happened was he introduced me to my homegirl, Portia Wright, a sweet piece cakery. Let me tell you about Miss Portia. Miss Portia studied bakery, baking, and pastries at Johnson & Wells. Not only did she study and graduate, she also worked with the Carolina Panthers as the in-house baker. So right now, Miss Portia's out here doing her own thing, again with Sweet Pea's Cakery. So y'all go check out Miss Portia. Let her know your man Mo sent you, all right? With all due respect, of course. Have yourself a good day.